Yes, thank you very much for this introduction. You have already really led perfect because I called this lecture Acute Neuropathic Pain, a Neglected Issue. You have already seen my disclosure. I think we really underestimate the incidence of neuropathic pain in the acute setting. We underappreciate the impact and we undertreat the pain. And it's really interesting, when you look into the literature, there's literally one review on acute neuropathic pain in the whole anesthetic and analgesic literature, and it's written by Paul Gray in Brisbane, and it's only written because I'm the editor-in-chief of Current Opinion of Anesthesiology, the pain part, and I asked him to write this review. And there is no other review of this topic. So let's look a little bit at what we know about this. I think the big problem is that hopefully you are not all only anesthetists, but also some pain medicine specialists, because anesthetists are very good running acute pain services and looking after nociceptive pain. But you have often much more training in anesthesia than in pain medicine, and therefore often you don't make the diagnosis of neuropathic pain. And the tools which we have in chronic pain to identify neuropathic pain, screening questionnaires and systems like that, are underutilized by acute pain services. But on the other hand, if you think about a list of neuropathic pain states, I have highlighted everything which could theoretically appear in an emergency department or on a ward, from acute shingles in an internal medicine ward to phantom limb pain, CRPS, post-surgery, post-trauma, and in particular burns pain, to spinal cord injury, to multiple sclerosis, where often acute neuropathic pain is the first presentation of a multiple sclerosis which wasn't diagnosed. So you can see it is not as rare as we actually think. There is actually also one overarching review, and it is written by Chris Hayes from New South Wales, he is the last dean of the Faculty of Pain Medicine of the Australian New Zealand College of Anaesthetists. There's a long abbreviation here. That is the analog to your two-year training program we heard about in Australia. And he wrote a prospective survey, and he found that there is around 3% of the patients his acute pain service were seeing had acute neuropathic pain. And he said our estimate of incidence is conservative because they didn't use very sophisticated means to diagnose it. If they looked at the cause, then you see surgery was around a quarter, trauma was around 40%, and the remaining were mainly internal medicine diseases which caused acute neuropathic pain. Since then, there have been a number of studies. This is a use of a neuropathic screening tool, the LANS score, which is one of the established screening tools to identify neuropathic pain. And they looked at a mixed general and orthopedic surgical population day one after surgery and got a relatively similar number of 4.2%. There have been other studies. This is after cancer surgery, and they used the Pain Detect tool, which is another screening questionnaire very similar to LANS, but with the advantage that you only have to have the patient answer it. You don't need to do anything as a doctor. That's why you can give it out to patients and collect it. And they found 10% of patients who had cancer surgery had acute neuropathic pain. And they found something which is consistent in the chronic and acute pain literature, that if you have neuropathic pain, you have more severe pain. And that is true for the acute pace too. So if they compared the 10% who had acute neuropathic pain, their average pain scores were significantly higher than the patients who had only, in quotation mark, nociceptive pain. This is a study where they looked at a symptom for nerve injury after sternotomy for heart surgery, and dysesthesia was found in 54% of patients, and dysesthesia was positively associated with CABG and, very important again, with the severity of postoperative pain. Did you have dysesthesia, which is a neuropathic pain symptom, you had more severe postoperative pain. And neuropathic elements are often unrelieved by conventional opioid analgesia, which is the reason why often acute neuropathic pain is poorly treated. If you go to injuries, We are running the West Australian Burn Center at Royal Perth Hospital, now moved to Fiona Stanley Hospital. 42% of patients with burns injury would score positive on the French screening tool, DN4. And you see, this was acute pain in the first 48 hours in over 50% of burns injury patients, and it persisted into the 2 to 4 week post-burn injury period with still 9% of patients. And if you go to emergency departments as another example, then the prevalence of neuropathic pain in such patients was 21.4%, so 1 in 5 patients who present to an emergency department had a neuropathic pain component, and that was again diagnosed with a DN4, which is called DN4 because if you have more than 4 out of the 10 points, you are positive for neuropathic pain. And again, as I mentioned before, if you had neuropathic pain, this was associated with more intense pain with an odds ratio of 5. Persistent picture throughout, neuropathic pain is always worse than only nociceptive pain. Now, if you look at trauma and where does it actually come from, then it becomes even more surprising. If you look at these fractures, you would think, oh, this is bony injury. But if you look how many percent of these fracture patients had neuropathic pain, you see a simple bony injury in your orthopedic ward might actually have up to nearly 50% of neuropathic pain, depending where the fracture is. And I think this is a big issue when you see trauma patients, that you are treating their nociceptive pain, but if you do not ask for the right diagnosis, if you are not using screening tools or are trained in recognizing neuropathic pain, you will overlook these problems. And if you look where does it come from, then the lumbosacral plexus in these patients was the most common origin of the neuropathic pain. And I now really look at everybody with a pelvic fracture from the point of view, do you have radicular pain in your toes despite you have a pelvic fracture? And you will be surprised how many patients will actually tell you that. Another typical acute neuropathic pain with a major consequence for chronic pain is whiplash injury after car accidents. 34% of patients who were presented to an emergency department with a whiplash injury had neuropathic pain. This is a shortened lens, another screening questionnaire. Don't have time to go into all these. And a predominantly neuropathic pain component is related to a complex presentation of higher pain and disability and sensory hypersensitivity. So again, the same picture. So I think I've shown you from a large range of acute situations your APS is possibly seeing that you can have much more neuropathic pain than you ever thought you would encounter in your role. What can you do about it? If you are in an acute emergency situation, you have a patient with a brachial plexus avulsion or spinal cord injury, we go for immediate parenteral treatment, and the two treatment options we will discuss in more detail are ketamine and lidocaine. Oral, you have first, second, and third line treatment options, and I will talk about these a little bit more. So, what can you do? If you use ketamine, and I would strongly advise you to use ketamine, then use an IV bolus, 5 milligrams, and step that up every 2 or 3 minutes while the patient is sitting in front of you. Somewhere between 5 or 25 milligrams, you will find a point where the patient is telling you that the pain is getting better. And if you go beyond that, possibly you get some slight psychomimetic side effects and should stop. To maintain the effect, the recommended infusion dose is 0.1 milligram per kilogram per hour, which would for a 70 kilogram patient mean 7 milligrams per hour. You can also maintain that as a subcut infusion if you have longer lasting problems in a rehab unit. And we are increasingly using sublingual ketamine wafers, and we have actually a product now which is developed by a Singaporean startup company. It has already a trade name, Wafermine, and it is currently in around 13 RCTs with a goal of going to the FDA registration and then worldwide registration. And we can use it in Australia already under an exemption in all our patients. The alternative is lidocaine. And in the literature, you will find some very interesting case reports about excellent results. parenteral administration, initial bolus 1 to 2 milligrams per kilogram out of your hand. So whatever, 140 to 100 to 200 milligrams IV, and then continue the infusion with 1 to 2 milligrams per minute. One of the problems is that a lot of cardiologists in a lot of hospitals will not let an Lignocaine infusion go to a normal ward without ECG monitoring, which makes it very hard to run them. But the other drawback of lidocaine is that it is not as good as ketamine, and that has been nicely shown in Scandinavia. I don't know if the author is possibly even here, but they did a head-on-head comparison in acute neuropathic pain of IV lidocaine versus IV ketamine. And if you look at the number of responders who had more than 50% pain relief, ketamine was beating lidocaine by far. And if you look at the pain reduction, ketamine was beating lidocaine by far. And that really means that our service has pretty much given up on IV lidocaine and is using it only as a second line response, and is using ketamine, which is much easier to monitor, can go to any normal ward. You will never get a respiratory arrest from ketamine. It's a routine technique in our hospital, which does not require any special nursing care or any monitoring. There is a supportive study many years later. It's coming actually from the same group, and they looked at spinal cord injury, and the same result. So this is the number of responders. And you see ketamine beats lidocaine in acute neuropathic pain of spinal cord injury. And this is the response, so the reduction in pain. And again, ketamine beats lidocaine. And this has also been confirmed again later in 2013 by a Japanese group. They gave a test challenge exactly as we do with 5 milligrams of ketamine. If they got a satisfactory response, they went to intravenous and oral ketamine. All 13 patients who had acute neuropathic pain after spinal cord injury responded in this case report. At cessation of treatment, the pain was on average reduced by 75% in comparison to the start pain intensity, and the average administration period was 17 days, and that shows why it is easier if you use sublingual wafers, because maintaining an IV line or subcut access for that time is possibly not as convenient. So our clear decision is parenteral ketamine first line, lignocaine only in desperation. And we had recently a tragic case of a lady who had a multiple sclerosis first manifestation by a lesion in the cervical spine. She became a quadriplegic, being a member of the Australian badminton team. Within one day, she became a tetraplegic. And the only thing we could ever do for her to maintain her pain control was a combined lidocaine ketamine infusion. Change to any oral drug invented by mankind to treat neuropathic pain was unable to control her pain, and she stayed until her death on ketamine lidocaine infusion because we couldn't offer her any other pain relief. If you have a little bit more time, you can follow what is actually in the guidelines, and this is again heavily influenced by Scandinavia, as you can see by many authors, including Nanna Finnerup as the key author in Lancet Neurology. Pharmacotherapy, this is the summary by the special interest group Neuropathic Pain of the IASP, and they came out with 3 first-line treatments, gabapentin, pregabalin, SNRIs, duloxetine, venlafaxine, or tricyclic antidepressants, amitriptyline or triptyline. They came out with second-line treatments, where in particular tramadol makes a lot of sense, and recommend opioids only as third-line treatment, not because they are not as effective, but because you get so many more problems, and you heard from Ordun how big these problems can be. But if you are in an acute neuropathic pain setting, then you have the problem that SNRIs and tricyclic antidepressants take a long time to work. And therefore, the order we are suggesting in a book we publish always in parallel to the guidelines, which is our cookbook, we call it, for the guidelines, we actually say opioids, including tramadol, tapentadol, play a more important role than in the chronic setting because of fast onset. And pregabalin, even more than gabapentin, is recommended over tricyclics and SNRIs because, again, faster onset and quick titration. And I don't know what your experience is, but if you have somebody with a brachial plexus avulsion who does not need
IV lercocaine, you give 150 milligrams pregabalin in the evening, you come the next morning, the pain is already dramatically reduced. If they are not sedated and are young and fit and healthy, and a lot of these are bike riders who are very tough, we give them 300 milligrams in the morning and you often have complete control within of 24 hours, which you would never get with a tricyclic as an SNRI. They can be used, but they would need much more. If you use pregabalin, as I mentioned, titrate much quicker. If I would never do that in an outpatient who has to drive a car and go to work, but I can do it in a patient who lies in bed after a severe traffic accident, go very quickly to 600 milligrams per day. You get also improved sleep and reduced anxiety. If they then have cognitive impairment, you can wind the dose back while they start their rehabilitation. Tricyclics start much lower, titrate quickly, but you don't get such a quick effect. And SNRIs, again, titrate quickly, but you get less sedation and adverse events, but pregabalin beats in time frame all of these treatments. Now, why is it possibly more important than we ever thought to treat acute neuropathic pain? Because already Chris Hayes in his study, you remember the 3% neuropathic pain of an acute pain service, could show of those people who had neuropathic pain on day 1, 2, or 3 after an operation or an accident, 78% reported persistent pain at 6 months, and 56% reported persistent pain at 12 months. And therefore, possibly what you see, if you look for acute neuropathic pain in the first 3 days, is a patient who is drifting towards a chronic neuropathic pain syndrome in the postoperative period. And there is clearly very good data to support the earlier you treat something like that, the less you will get chronification. And you saw that before, what chronic pain does after surgery, and you saw there that it often has a neuropathic pain component, and it is a consequence of intraoperative nerve injury. And therefore, the key messages I want to finish: A, acute neuropathic pain occurs after trauma and surgery, and we have better and better data to say that it occurs more often than we thought. The treatment should involve ketamine as a parenteral treatment, opioids, including in particular tramadol and tapentadol, because of their specific effects in neuropathic pain, and alpha-2-delta ligands because of the fast onset. And very important, if you diagnose and subsequently treat acute neuropathic pain appropriately early, you may prevent the development of chronic pain later. And I will leave you with these key messages, and thank you for your attention.